Hi, in this video tutorial, we will discuss about the concept of object-oriented programming in C++. First, we will discuss about the concept of object-oriented programming in C++. For that, the object-oriented programming actually divide the entire problem into a number of entities called objects. Then, the data and functions we can build around these objects. In the figure you can see that we can divide our entire problem into different objects like object A, object B, object C, like that. And we can build data and functions around these objects. So you can see that each object contains data and functions. And also one object can communicate with other object. This concept is called as object-oriented programming. Next, we will discuss about the basic concepts of object-oriented programming. There are mainly seven basic concepts we are going to discuss under object-oriented programming. The first one is class, second one is object, third one is data abstraction and encapsulation, fourth one is inheritance, fifth one is polymorphism, sixth one is dynamic binding, and the seventh one is message passing. You will see one by one in detail with examples. One of the basic concepts of object-oriented programming is class. Class is similar to structure in C++. That is, it is actually a user-defined data type which holds its own data members and member functions. The data members and member functions we can access or used by creating an instance of that class. So it is also called as a blueprint for an object. For example, suppose that we are taking cars as class. Then you know that there are many cars are available in the market with different names and different brands, but all of them have some common features or properties like four wheels, speed limits, mileage, etc. So a car is a class, and wheels, speed limit and mileages are their properties. So as I told you earlier, a class holds data members and member functions. The data members means the data variables or simply variables, and member functions are the functions that is used to manipulate these variables. These data members and member functions together defines the properties and behavior of the object in a class. For example, in the previous case, we have taken car as a class. The data members will be the speed limit, mileage, etc. And then the member functions can be apply brakes, increase speed, etc. Next, we will discuss about the another important concept of object-oriented programming, that is object. An object is an instance of a class. That is, the importance of object in object-oriented programming is the class gets its memory allocated only after an object is created. Then how to create a class and how to create object, all these we will discuss in the next slide. Next, we will discuss about how to define class and how to declare objects. For defining a class, you have to use a keyword class before the class name. The class name can be a user defined name. Then inside the curly brackets, you can write the body of the class that include access specifiers, data members and member functions. We will see how to declare an object in the next slide. Next, we will see How to declare an object for a class. When a class is defined, no memory or storage is allocated for that class. If you want to allocate memory for a class, you have to create object of that class. Then only you can use the data and access functions defined in the class. For that, you have to create an object of that class. The syntax for creating an object for a class is class name followed by the object name. Then for accessing the data members and the member functions, you can use a dot operator along with the object. For example, if you want to access a function print name that is present inside a class, that can be accessed by using the object of that class. Suppose obj is the name of the object, then the function print name can be accessed by using the dot operator along with object obj. So the syntax is obj dot print name of, that will allow you to access the function print name from that class. Accessing data members of a class depends on the access control of that data member. That means the access control is based on the access modifiers or access specifiers. There are mainly three access modifiers or access specifiers are there. First one is public, second one is private, and third one is protected. First, we will discuss about public access specifier or a public access modifier. If you are declared your data and functions under public access specifier, you can access your data member and member functions anywhere in that program. That means you can access your data and functions inside that class, outside that class, that can also accessed by other classes. All these are possible. Then that can be done by using the dot operator along with the object of that class. So in the case of public access specifier, you can access your data member and member functions anywhere in that program. Next is private access specifier. If you are declared your data member under private access specifier, that can be accessed only by the functions inside that class, that is the member functions of that class and also the friend functions of that class. That means these data members are not allowed to access by any object or functions outside that class. That is only accessible inside that class by the member functions of that class. And also a friend function can also access that data members. Then next is protected access specifier. If you have declared your data member under protected access specifier, it is almost similar to the private access specifier or private access modifiers. The difference is that if you have declared your data member inside protected access specifier, that can be accessed by any member functions of that class and also the member functions of any derived class of that class. That means the protected data members are not accessible to outside of that class except the subclass or derived class of that class. Another important concept of object-oriented programming is data abstraction and encapsulation. First, we will see what is data encapsulation. The wrapping up of data and functions together in a class into a single unit is known as data encapsulation. Here, the data is only accessible to the function which is wrapped inside that class. it is not accessible to the outside world. These functions provide the interface between the object's data and the program. This insulation of data from direct access by the program is called data hiding or information hiding. Then comes the data abstraction. This is the way of representing essential features without including the background details. That means it will include only the essential features by hiding the background details. That is called as data abstraction. Classes uses the concept of abstraction. The fourth important concept of object-oriented programming is inheritance. First, we will see what is inheritance. Deriving a new class from an existing class is called as inheritance. The old class or the existing class is called as base class, and the new class which is derived from the existing class is called as derived class or subclass. If you want to use the data member and member functions of an existing class in a new class, instead of writing new data member and member functions all over again, the programmer can make a bonding of the new class with the existing class so that the new class can access or use the data members and member functions of the existing class. This property is called as inheritance. That is, the new class should inherit the members of the existing class in such cases. It is also possible to derive a new class from more than one existing class. That means it can inherit data and functions from multiple base classes. This concept is called as inheritance. Next, we will see how to perform inheritance in C++. The syntax is class, derived class name, colon, visibility mode, base class name. The visibility mode actually indicating how base classes are viewed with respect to the derived class. For example, when one class gets inherited from another class, the visibility mode is used to inherit all the public and protected members of the base class. The private members never get inherited and hence do not take part in visibility. By default, visibility mode remains private. What is base class and what is derived class? First, we will see what is a base class. The class from which the derived class get inherited is known as the base class. Then it is also act as a parent class for its child classes. Then the public and protected members of the base class get inherited to its derived classes. Then the derived class means it is specifying its relationship with the base class in addition to its own members. The syntax for defining a derived class is class, derived class name, colon, visibility mode, base class name, that we already discussed in the previous slide. Then inside this derived class, you can write members of the derived class. This derived class can also access the members of the base class if it is declared as public or protected. The private members never get inherited to the derived class. Next, we will discuss about different types of inheritance or different forms of inheritance. There are mainly five forms or types for inheritance. The first one is single inheritance, multiple inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, multi-level inheritance, and hybrid inheritance. It is also called as virtual inheritance. These figures are self-explanatory and this will give you the clear idea about what do you mean by different forms of inheritance. The first one is single inheritance. Here you can see that a class P which is derived from a class A. That means a class is derived from a single base class. Such kind of inheritance is called as single inheritance. Next you can see that multiple inheritance. That means a class C is inherited from class A and class B. That means a class is derived from more than one base classes. Such kind of inheritance is called as multiple inheritance. The next one is hierarchical inheritance. Here you can see that the class B, C and D is inherited from class A. So A is the base class. So more than one class is derived from a single base class is called as hierarchical inheritance. And the next one is multi-level inheritance. Here you can see that the class C is inherited from another class, class B, and the class B is also inherited from a class, class A. So this kind of inheritance, that is a class is derived from another class which is also derived from another class. Such kind of inheritance is called as multi-level inheritance. And the final one is hybrid inheritance or virtual inheritance. Actually, this is a combination of more than one inheritance types or inheritance forms. That is called as hybrid inheritance. These are the explanations of the figure we discussed in the previous slide. First, we discussed about single inheritance in figure A. In single inheritance, there is only one base class and one derived class. And the derived class get inherited from its base class. This kind of simple form of inheritance is called as single inheritance. The next one is multiple inheritance. In figure B, we discussed about multiple inheritance. In multiple inheritance, a single derived class may get inherited from two or more base classes. Next, we will see an example of multiple inheritance in the next slide. This example will give you the basic idea about how to write an object-oriented program using class and the concept of inheritance. In this example, we will discuss about the multiple inheritance program. For that, I have defined a class A. The syntax is the keyword class followed by the class name, that is A. Then inside the class, I have defined a function A of under the access specifier public. So public colon inside public access specifier, I have defined a function A of that contains cout A's constructor is called. Then the function is closed. The class is ended. Next, I have defined another class, class P. Then inside that class, I have defined a function P of under public access specifier. Then I have defined a class, class C, which is actually derived from class B and class A. The syntax is the keyword class, the derived class name is C colon, which is derived from class B and class A. The public stands for the visibility mode. So class A colon public B comma public A. You have to write the second class first. That is the format. Then inside that class, I have another function C of, which is defined under public access specifier that contains C's constructor is called. Then the class C is ended. Then inside the main function, I have created an object of class C, the syntax is the class name that is C, object name is small c. Then by using this object, we can access the data members and member functions of these classes. So this is a simple program for understanding the concept of object-oriented programming in C++ and also the concept of class and object, then how to define a class, how to create objects, then how to use the concept of inheritance in object-oriented programming, all these. The next type of inheritance is hierarchical inheritance that we have discussed in the figure C. In hierarchical inheritance, multiple derived classes get inherited from a single base class. That is, two or more classes derived from single base class. The syntax for hierarchical inheritance is, first you have to define your base class. Syntax is class, base class name. Inside that you can write your methods, mention your properties, etc. Then you can derive two or more classes from this base class. So the first derived class is derived class 1. So for deriving derived class 1 from base class, the syntax is class derived class 1 colon visibility mode base class name. Then you can mention the properties and methods of that class inside derived class 1. Then for deriving another class, derived class 2 from the base class, syntax is class derived class 2 colon visibility mode base class name. Then you can mention the properties and methods inside that class. And similarly, you can derive n number of classes from the same base class. So the syntax is class derived class n colon visibility mode base class name. Then inside that we can mention the properties and methods. So here you can see that the derived class 1, derived class 2, etc. derived class n are derived from a single base class, which is base class name. So this is the format you have to follow when you are writing a C++ program for hierarchical inheritance. The next type of inheritance is multi-level inheritance. In multi-level inheritance, a class can get inherited from the classes that are already derived. Then the next type of inheritance is hybrid inheritance. In hybrid inheritance, it is a mixture of two or more inheritance types. In this type of inheritance, a code may contain two or three types of inheritance in single code. The fifth important concept of object-oriented programming is polymorphism. Polymorphism means the ability to take more than one form. That means an operation may exhibit different behavior at different instances. The behavior may depend upon the type of data used in that operation. For example, if you consider an operation addition, if you are going to add two numbers using plus operator, it will give you the sum. Suppose your operands are strings, so you are going to sum two strings by using the operator plus. The result of this operation will be a concatenated string. So the operator plus behave in different ways if the operands are different. This process of making an operator to exhibit different behaviors in different instances is known as operator overloading. This is one kind of polymorphism. Similarly, we discussed function overloading earlier. Another example of polymorphism is function overloading that we have already discussed under function overloading section. Here we will see one more example for function overloading. In function overloading, here we have a function draw that will draw circle, box or rectangle based on the object you are used for calling that function. If your object is circle object, it will draw a circle. If your object is box object, it will draw a box. If you are calling that function by using triangle object, it will draw a triangle. So this way, a function can behave in different ways based on the object you are using. This is called as function overloading, and this is a kind of polymorphism. Another basic concept of object-oriented programming is dynamic binding. Dynamic binding means linking of a procedure call to the code to be executed in response to that call. That means the code associated with a given procedure call is not known until the time of call at runtime. It's also associated with polymorphism and inheritance. Next, we will see another concept of object-oriented programming, that is message passing. In the case of object-oriented programming, the entire problem is divided into different objects, and this object can communicate each other. The process of programming in an object-oriented language involves some steps. They are, the first step is creating classes that define objects and their behavior. The second step is creating objects from class definitions. Then the third step is establishing communication among objects. A message for an object is a request for an execution of a procedure, and therefore it will invoke a function in the receiving object that generates the desired results. The message passing involves specifying the name of object, the name of the function, and the information to be sent. Next, we will see constructors in C++. First, we look at what is constructor. A constructor is a special member function of a class. Or we can say that a constructor is a function in a class which initializes objects of a class. That means a constructor is automatically called when an object is created. The special member function or the constructor actually different from normal member functions. Then how they are different from normal member function? There are mainly four differences. The first one is constructor has the same name as the class name. So both constructor name and the class name is same. Second difference is constructors do not have return type. Third difference is a constructor is automatically called when an object is created. And the final difference is if we do not specify a constructor, the C++ compiler generates a default constructor for us. The default constructor has no parameters and has an empty body. Next, we will discuss about the syntax for defining a constructor function in a class. For that, I have defined a class A. Syntax is class A. Inside the class, inside the public access specifier, I have declared a variable X, and also I have defined a function a of, which is a constructor function. Because you can see the name of the function, it is a, and the class name is same. So both class name and constructor name is same. Inside the constructor, you can do the object initialization. So this is the syntax for defining a constructor function in a class. Next, we will see an example of constructor in object-oriented programming in C++. So two important points you want to remember while defining the constructor is the name of the constructor will be same as the name of the class. And the second point is the constructors will never have a return type. So constructor can be defined either inside the class or outside the class. If you are going to define the constructor outside the class, you have to use the scope resolution operator along with the class name. So you can see here an example. Here I have defined a class, class A. Then inside that, under the access specifier public, I have declared a variable I and I have declared a function AF, which is a constructor function. Here you can see that this function has the same name as the class name. The both class name and the constructor name is A, and the constructor function has no return type. Then here in this example, I have defined the constructor function outside the class. So the syntax is A scope resolution operator AO. The first A stands for the class name, then scope resolution operator, then the constructor name, that is AO. Inside that, I have initialized value of I as 1. So this is a simple example for writing a constructor in C++. There are mainly three types of constructors. The first one is default constructor, second one is parameterized constructor, and the third one is copy constructor. We will see one by one. The first type of constructor is default constructor. The speciality of default constructor is it does not take any argument and it has no parameters. This C++ program will illustrate you the concept of constructors. Here I have defined a class construct. Inside that class, I have declared variables A and B and defined a function construct, which is a default constructor. Because here you can see that the constructor name or function name is same as the class name and it does not have any return type and it does not take any arguments or no parameters. So it is a default constructor. Inside the constructor, I have initialized A value as 10 and B value as 20. Then inside the main function, when I create object for the class construct, the default constructor called automatically. So we all know when an object is created, the default constructor called automatically. So for that, I have created an object of class construct by using the syntax construct object name. So here the object name is C. So construct C will create an object C and the default constructor called automatically. Then I displayed A and B values using Cout. So that is done by using C.A and C.B. C.A will give you the value 10 and C.B will give you the value 20. C is the object name. A is the variable name or the data member. So even if we do not define any constructors explicitly, the compiler will automatically provide a default constructor implicitly. We are not going in detail about other type of constructors like parameterized constructor and copy constructor. We will discuss about the basics of parameterized constructor and copy constructor. So the next one is parameterized constructor. The basic idea of parameterized constructor is It is also possible to pass arguments to constructors. So that will help you to initialize an object when it is created. So to create a parameterized constructor, you have to add parameters to that function or constructor like any other function. So when you define the constructor's body, use the parameters to initialize the object. The next type of constructor is copy constructor. A copy constructor is a member function which initializes an object using another object of the same class. Next we will see destructors in C++. So a destructor is a special function in a class which destroys the object as soon as the scope of the object ends. So the destructor is called automatically by the compiler when the object goes out of scope. The syntax for defining a destructor is same as the constructor. That means the destructor name is same as the class name, and a tilde symbol is added prefix to the destructor name. We will see the syntax and example in the next slide. This is the syntax for defining a destructor in object-oriented programming. For that, I have defined a class A inside the class. Under the public access specifier, I have defined a function AO, which is a destructor function, because here you can see that the function name is same as the class name and a tilde symbol is used before the function name. Another important point you want to notice is a destructor will never have any arguments. So here there is no argument to function A. So the function A is a destructor function. Inside function A, you can write down the statements. So this is the syntax for defining a destructor in object-oriented programming in C++. This C++ program illustrates how constructor and destructor are called. Here, I have defined a class, class A, and inside the class A, I have defined a constructor function AOF. Inside AOF, there is a cout statement, cout constructor called. So this cout statement will be executed whenever an object of class A is created. Then I have defined a destructor function AOF. Inside that, there is a cout statement, destructor called. So this will be executed whenever the scope of the object of class A ends. So inside the main function, I have created an object of class A, obj1. So this will execute or call the constructor. So you will get output like constructor called. So whenever an object of class A is created, it will automatically call the constructor. So you will get output like constructor called. Then the next statement is, a variable x is initialized with value 1. Then if of x is true, another object for class A is created, that is obj2. So this time also the constructor will be called, because here also the object of class A is created, so the constructor again called. So you will get output like constructor called. Then when you close the curly bracket of this statement, if statement, the scope of the object 2 ends. So the destructor tilde AOF will be called and you will get output like destructor code. Then when you end main function by closing it using the curly bracket, the destructor again called because the scope of object 1 ends when you end the main function using the curly bracket close. So you will get output like destructor called again. So the final output will be constructor called, then destructor called, so I can summarize it like this. When an object is created, the constructor of that class is called. The object reference is destroyed when its scope ends, that is, after closing the curly bracket for the code block in which it is created. The object 2 is destroyed when the if block ends because it was created inside the if block. And the object 1 is destroyed when the main of function ends. So this will give you the clear idea about how constructor and destructor are called. In this video tutorial, we are discussing about object-oriented programming concepts. There is also another type of programming concept, that is procedure-oriented programming. In procedure-oriented programming approach, the entire program is divided into different functions or sub-functions. But in object-oriented programming, the entire program is divided into different objects. We will see what are the major difference between object-oriented programming and procedure-oriented programming in the next slide. The major difference between procedure-oriented and object-oriented programming are: the first difference is, in procedure-oriented programming, the program is divided into small parts called as functions. But in object-oriented programming, the program is divided into small parts called as objects. Then second difference is, in procedure oriented programming, importance is given to functions rather than data. But in object oriented programming, importance is given to data rather than procedures or functions. In procedure oriented programming, it follows top down approach. But object-oriented programming follows bottom-up approach. In procedure-oriented programming, it does not have any access specifiers. But in object-oriented programming, we have three access specifiers: public, private, and protected. In procedure-oriented programming, data can move from one function to another function freely in that system. But in object-oriented programming, the objects can move and communicate with each other through the member functions. The next difference is, in procedure-oriented programming, adding new data and function is not so easy. But in the case of object-oriented programming, we can add data and functions easily. In procedure-oriented programming, most functions uses global data for sharing that can be accessed freely from function to function in the system. But in object-oriented programming, data cannot move easily from function to function. It can be kept public or private, so we can control the access of data. Procedure-oriented programming is less secure, but object-oriented programming is more secure as compared to procedure-oriented programming. In procedure-oriented programming, overloading is not possible. But in object-oriented programming, we can perform function overloading and operator overloading. The example for procedure-oriented programming languages are C, VB, Visual Basic, Fortran, Pascal, etc. Then example for object-oriented programming are C++, Java, VP.NET, C#.NET, and most of the modern programming languages are object-oriented. Next, we will discuss about the features of object-oriented programming. These features we have already discussed earlier in this video tutorial. So, here we will discuss the main points that will come under the features of object-oriented programming. The first feature is it embraces on data rather than procedure, that we already discussed. The next one is, in object-oriented programming, the programs are divided into different objects. The next feature is, the data structures are designed such that they characterize the objects. Next feature is, functions that operate on the data of an object are tied together in the data structure. Next feature is, data is hidden and cannot be accessed by external function. Then the object may communicate with each other through function. Then the new data and functions can be easily added whenever necessary. And the next feature is, it follows bottom-up approach in program design. That's all about the features of object-oriented programming. The major application areas of object-oriented programming are real-time system, simulation and modeling, object-oriented databases, hypertext, hypermedia and expert text, AI and expert systems, neural networks and parallel programming, decision support and office automation systems, SIM, CAM or CAD systems, etc. This is the end of video tutorial of object-oriented programming in C++, and also this is the end of module 4 of computer programming and computational techniques. Thank you.